All right, it's 1:30, so let's get started with the model-driven telemetry on Cisco IOS XE made simple. Can everyone hear me okay? Yep, nope, yep. Can you hear me? Yep, all right, getting a little bit up and down here. We're just adjusting the levels over here, so we'll get it going, hopefully dialed in so you can hear me all right by the end of the session. But for now, I'll just start going through this. Hopefully we can get this, my clicker works. Okay, I got to move closer and get the clicker to work, no problem. So this is what we'll be talking about for the next half an hour or so. We'll give an overview of telemetry on iOS XE. So we understand the feature, right? What are we talking about when we're talking about telemetry? How do we configure it? What's available? We'll talk about Yang Suite. Yang Suite is the tooling that we use to interact with the API that we can subscribe to telemetry with. We'll talk about the Yang data models. Yang data models define the APIs. It's our API documentation, if you will, is the Yang data models. Probably the most valuable part of the session, in my opinion, is going to be the telemetry with Yang Suite. I basically have four slides in here that give you all the details about what you need to do to be successful with creating a telemetry subscription from the tooling, Yang Suite, to your iOS XE device. There's three or four different flavors of telemetry, so I have examples for each of those so that you can be successful with them. We'll look at a case study about power over Ethernet, right? So we'll look at power telemetry, power utilization, how much watts, how much voltage we're consuming from our PoE devices and from our switch overall. I have a prescription in here so you can reproduce this and you can copy and clone down the prescription and the dashboard files. And then we'll close this up with the resources, the training. I've got a slide in here called the dojos. Dojo is basically, you know, the area where we can go and train, practice on this. Right? We have a couple that are available that you can log into, you can reserve. We have some that are always on. So we'll talk about that. How's the audio? Is audio is okay in the back there? Okay, great. So when we take a very high-level look at the programmability and automation lifecycle on iOS XE, there's kind of four main buckets that we have that we group this feature set into. Today, we're on the right. We're talking about the API, the core API, which is netconf, GNMI for telemetry. But really, it's the bottom right, right? It's all of the knobs, all of the features, all of the innovation that's available within the telemetry ecosystem on iOS XE. If you want to talk about any of these other features, any of this automation stuff, we have other sessions this week where we go deep into zero-touch provisioning. We go deep into the Terraform tooling. We go deep into the Yang Suite. So lots of other sessions and related sessions throughout the week here. Let's double click a little bit on model-driven telemetry, the three model-driven telemetry interfaces. There's really four that I have listed on here, but really only three support telemetry or a push or a pub-sub type of mechanism. Netconf is the RFC standards telemetry protocol. We don't use this. You don't use this. We do, actually, in Cisco. We use netconf between Cisco and Cisco solutions. So between the Cisco Catalyst Center and your iOS XE, we're using a netconf connection. You can also use this netconf connection, but you typically choose not to because there's better options. What are the better options here? GNMI and gRPC. That's really where we see customers implementing model-driven telemetry as a replacement for SNMP. And to get better insights into what's happening in the network operations or network devices. You'll see some code samples and some CLI config samples from gRPC. Right? As network engineers, this is the most familiar to us when we see CLIs to configure a telemetry feature. Compare this to GNMI where iOS XE is a server. It just listens. There's a port listening, and your tooling has to dial in to that port, has to dial in, make a connection to the device, and then subscribe to telemetry. Ask for specific information. Hey, every 5 seconds, tell me what the CPU is at. Hey, every 60 seconds, push me all the counters for my interfaces that I'm interested in. So there's some of the options that are available. You'll see this in the demo coming up towards the end, where we use Telegraf, InfluxDB, and Grafana. This is a software solution we've baked into the training environments that receives the telemetry, it stores it, and then it processes it and makes it available for visualization. The visualization tool here is Grafana, right? This is where we can actually take all of that raw telemetry data and visualize it. We can understand intelligence from it and understand when it goes up and down, or when we lose data, or when weird things happen on the network. Double-clicking into this dashboard a little bit more, I've posted two links on here for the exact dashboard that you're seeing. And then there's another one for a wireless dashboard. So if you're running a Cisco 9800 wireless controller, then we have some prescriptions, some code samples for how to get some basic client information, some basic access point, and general just health information about what's happening with your wireless network. In the demo that you'll see, there's like really one or two main counters that we're looking at, right? First and foremost, like CPU and memory, right? One of the most easiest, most commonly understood things to instrument and look at, right? We can do show process or show memory, and we can look at that at a point in time. But when we subscribe to this, we can really understand when we see dips or increases or spikes in memory or utilizations. Same thing with wireless. We can look at very detailed wireless stats, wireless client stats, channel roaming. This is a really interesting one up here. If you actually like take some time to digest this, we're looking at channel change or channel utilization. So it's a really good metric to understand the health of the wireless network. This is the prescription that we have for wireless. We have like 20 XPaths or 20 sensor paths or 20 data points. And these are the 20 data points that you need to have a complete visibility and understanding about what's happening in your wireless network, from client health, access point health, RRM, radio resources, channel utilizations, temperature of the controller, the physical temperature of the box in the data center, right? We're even monitoring and instrumenting that. Now, all of these XPaths, we put them on here so you can very easily copy paste them or turn those on your device. But let's really understand where these come from. And where these come from is the Yang data models. Now, we publish all of these data models on github.com. Right? With every iOS XE release, we push the API definition or the API documentation onto GitHub so that you can easily go and browse it and understand some of the new innovations or features that we've added. I've called out some of the most common data models here, run and config. What's the data model for my run and config? How can I understand what I've actually configured on these interfaces or all these features? Cisco IOS XE native.yang, that models all of the running configuration. So you can do a get against that model, and then you'll be able to have a full understanding of what you've configured. We have some of the most common data models on here as well. IOS XE interfaces oper, operational data about interfaces on your device. Stats and counters, how much throughput, how much drops, how much errors, all of that sort of stuff is modeled in interfaces offer. We've got quite a rich telemetry history on iOS XE. Right? We're still doing some CLI scraping, we're still doing some SNMP polling, but now we're moving to a more model-driven approach where we're able to push data when it becomes available. Right? We no longer need to pull for data that might be stale. Now we can actually push data to us as it's updated and as it changes. As you can see, there's a couple different telemetry interfaces, right? We talked about NetConf at the beginning, which is primarily Cisco on Cisco. We don't see a lot of customer use of that. But gRPC and GNMI is definitely where we see and have a lot of customers in production using this telemetry at scale within campuses and across WANs as well. So lots of different options for which API interface or which telemetry interface you want to use. And really what goes into this is your preferences, your tooling preferences, your security preferences, as well as your network architecture, right? Does your tooling have access to your devices? Or does your device have access to the tooling? Depending on firewalls and security posture, your answers may differ. So with gRPC dial out, we're going to be pushing telemetry to a server. Right? So as long as that server is accessible, then the telemetry is going to get there. But with GNMI, then iOS XE needs to be accessible from your tooling. So your tooling needs to make that connection into the device and then subscribe to the data. So different considerations for different protocols. And one of the real main considerations here is security. How do you want to get that telemetry data? Does it need to be encrypted over the wire, or is plain text okay? Do you want to authenticate with a username? Do you want to authenticate with a certificate? Combination of both? Do you want to have some role-based access control in there for what sensor paths you can actually subscribe to? All sorts of different considerations. And that really leads customers to choose one API interface over the other. It's the same data, the same data models, the same update. Right? So really, it's the encoding and the formatting that changes. As far as publication options go, two main flavors. Periodic is the most commonly understood, where we say every 5 seconds, every 10 seconds, every 60 seconds, push me an update. Right? Tell me what the temperatures are. Tell me what the stats are. Tell me what the counters are. We see a lot of periodic telemetry. 99% of it is periodic, right? We want to get the same data at the same interval, and we want to look at that over time. But we also support on-change telemetry. So on-change telemetry is really interesting because we have events that are modeled here. Events like a login failure, like an optic fault, route changes, for example. All of these are modeled in the events operational or the events data models. So we can find the XPath and subscribe to a bunch of those. You see a link coming up where I have examples. I have about 40 sensor paths from Cisco IT who's using this feature. So they get essentially a trap or a notification when certain things happen. Then while we're talking about telemetry, often the SNMP feature comes up. And we want to talk about migrating from SNMP to telemetry or benefiting from the innovation in telemetry that's not in SNMP. More data, more granular data, updated more frequently with less impact to the device. That's the summary from this slide here. Essentially, when you're polling, it's going to cost you like a 6% CPU tax if you're just polling the CPU status. But if you're using telemetry, that's going to cost you about 2%. And that's what we see here, which is the cost of model-driven telemetry. Right? What are the speeds and feeds when we're consuming this stuff? So in this example here, we're subscribing to 17 XPaths. So it's just a whole bunch of common data, the interfaces. We have all the processes, the PoE, all the platform stuff, so about line cards and optics, your memory stats, your LLDP, your CDP stats, the running config, right? So we're collecting a whole ton of data at a 60-second update interval, and then we're just placing the thermometer in different places, right? How fast are we publishing data? What's the packets that we're pushing out here? And what's the cost to the CPU? Right, so we're monitoring and instrumenting all of that to understand, is this going to break the network? Or is this going to cause, your switch to just consume all the CPU or saturate your uplink port and you're going to have a denial of service? So we're providing some of these to help you understand those. So in talking about Yank Suite is the tooling that we've been publishing for a couple of years now. We've been using it internally in Cisco for 5 or 6 or 7. We were able to publish this under a free license a couple years ago, so it's now available on developer.cisco.com. You can git clone this. You can also pip install this now as well. So we've made it a lot easier to install and manage the installation of this thing. As you see, it eats data models, right? You feed it data models. You feed it data models directly from GitHub or directly from your device. And that's what I use. I very rarely grab data models from GitHub. I almost always grab them from my device. Right? I connect to my device and I say, hey, give me all your data models. I want to understand exactly what you support. Let's pull that into the tooling and then work with it. So what's included in Yank Suite? There's a bunch of plugins here that make the tool actually usable. So of course, Yank Suite as the core tool. Then we added plugins for the RESTconf API, for the NetConf was supported at the beginning. GNMI as well, so we have a full-featured GNMI client, including with telemetry support. So we can dial in and we can subscribe to telemetry from Yank Suite. We also have some SNMP to Yang mapping conversion tool help here. The idea here is you can put in an OID that you're monitoring right now in your current SNMP monitoring systems, and it'll tell you the equivalent Yang data model. It'll tell you the XPath or the sensor path that you'll need to subscribe to instead of using an OID. So talking a little bit more about the data models, here in Yang Suite, I'm in the Explore Yang plugin, right? So when I'm in Explore Yang, we just get more information about the Yang data models. In this case, it's the model metadata, right? We see the prefix, the XPath, and the description. And the description is really interesting because we have description for every single leaf, every single part of the API is documented. So it'll tell you when you click on, for example, in this screenshot here where we're looking at CPU utilization, when we select the actual 5-minute or the 5-second metric, it'll tell us this is the average CPU, you know, averaged out over whatever the time frame was. We can generate our XPaths using a Jinja template. So when we have, you know, lots and lots of XPaths, like you saw in the example previously, where I have like 25 wireless XPaths, you know, let's not go conft and, you know, type those out time over time, but instead, you know, let's put it into a Jinja template and have Jinja create that so we can just blast that in and manage it. Jinja is one way, Terraform is one, Ansible is another, right? We support all sorts of integrations for actually managing the telemetry configuration. And when we're talking about managing the telemetry configuration, we also have the operational data model, right? So what's actually happening with your telemetry feature? Are your subscriptions connected? Are they? Is the data flowing? Do you have a bad XPath, or is your receiver disconnected? Maybe the port was wrong and you're having a connection failure. So we can pull the MDT operational Yang data model from the API, and we can understand exactly what's happening with this feature. We can also pull this other data model, which is the on-change telemetry data model. This is going to tell us which sensor paths support on-change and details of those changes. So for example, in the optic fault example that I mentioned earlier, you can load the data model into here or do a pull against the on-change telemetry list, and you'll see an entry for all of these events that are in here. So then you can understand that you can subscribe to those and you can catch those notifications when they happen. So let's talk about actually subscribing, consuming, viewing, and seeing this telemetry in the Yang Suite tooling. Here's the example with NetConf, right? So when we load the NetConf module in Yang Suite, there's a couple options that we need to select to be able to create a successful dial-in telemetry subscription. We need to tell it the stream and the encoding, Yang push and this type of key value pair encoding, the sensor XPath, and then the period. You know, how often do we want this data to be updated? Once we build this payload on the left, we can run it and we'll get data back from the device. We'll have a session open. Within that session, every 10 seconds or whatever that period is, we'll be getting this telemetry data. That's what we see here, right? The actual telemetry data is coming in and it's saying, yeah, your 5-second CPU is at, you know, zero, right? It's just sitting there doing nothing in this example here. So this is the NetConf. With gRPC dial out, we also have a server in Yang Suite. So you can turn on this additional plugin, which is the gRPC telemetry plugin. You can tell it what port you want to listen to, and it'll turn on a service listening for gRPC telemetry to be pushed to it. We can put that data out to a text file. We can push it out to an Elasticsearch database. And we can also turn on multiple receivers. So you can have a secure receiver or plain text and a non-plain text receiver. You can have receivers on different ports. So if you have 5 different devices and you want to validate telemetry from those 5 devices on 5 different ports, you have the flexibility within the Yang Suite tooling to do that. Some examples of what the data looks like, right? You'll get a decoded payload. For each payload that you get, it'll be decoded from the key value pair into a JSON string. So you can very easily understand what's happening in that JSON string. Each 10 seconds, we can see here that the CPU is being recorded as 1 or 0. Yeah, 1 in this case. With gRPC, we can also do some validation on the device. You can see on the right here, I'm doing a show telemetry CLI. That's going to give me all of the same information that we see in the MDT Opper Yang data model. It's going to tell us that it's connected, what port it's on, and that the data is flowing. This is an example of the CLI configuration needed for gRPC dial-out. It's 4 or 5 lines. You have a subscription number, details about the encoding and the filtering that you want to use, and then the update policy. You know, how often do you want it, and then where do you want this data sent to? In the example here, I'm pushing it to this IP address on the network, 10.1.1.3, on this port that's listening, 57344. You can put on any port. Typically, you'll see in our examples, it's like 57500 or 57000. When we use GNMI, we can also subscribe to the data models. And it's different depending on which data model you subscribe to, right? There's 2 different flavors of data models on iOS XE, or kind of 2 main flavors. One being Cisco native, ones that we maintain for all of the features that we innovate on and create. And then we have a standards-based or a vendor, a non-vendor, I should say, an operator data model ecosystem, which is called OpenConfig. OpenConfig data model ecosystem has been around for 5 or 6 years. It's growing in its maturity. So we have both native and OpenConfig models on the device. So in this example here, we're looking at Cisco native interfaces, right? We've seen this data model before, the stats and the counters for all your wired interfaces. In the next example, we'll see OpenConfig interfaces. It's the same physical interface, same stats, same counters, but it's just modeled in a different way, using different nomenclature, different descriptions, different keyed values. So when we subscribe to Cisco native, there's a couple options that we need to set, specifically the origin. The origin up here is 1915, RFC, not 1915, pardon me, 7951. That's a JSON kind of origin. So you need to set that when you work with Cisco native data models. If I advance the slide here to the OpenConfig option here, you'll see that the origin is not RFC 7951. It's OpenConfig. So it's a different set of metadata that we need to send, whether we're using Cisco native data model or the OpenConfig data models. Again, we see the decoded payload, where we see all the same stats and counters. And if I go back to the previous slide here, where we see the decoded payload again, it's all the same data, right? But it is modeled slightly differently. You'll notice if you look really closely, some of the names of these fields are modeled differently. So instead of being like a broadcast, for example, broadcast packets, it'll be the in broadcast packets or the out broadcast packets instead of just having one modeled. So this is how we can subscribe and use Yank Suite to actually dial in and collect and view the telemetry. Let's take a look at an actual case study or a use case where we're going to collect some data over time and understand what's happening with this feature. In the example here, we're using, I guess it's power telemetry from smart buildings. So we have our smart building, we have our Cisco Catalyst 9300Xs, we have all these UPoE endpoints drawing lots of power, we have all this like blinds and light switches and like all sorts of cool stuff. And let's understand how much power each of these things are drawing and how much power draw we have overall from the PoE subsystems. How do we replicate this type of thing? Right? There's basically 3 blocks of CLIs that we need to put in, or 3 sensor paths that will provide all of the needed information for this use case. It's all coming from the PoE operational data model. We're looking at PoE specifically on the port level, PoE at the switch level, and PoE at the stack level. Right? So there's 3 different places where we can put the thermometer to understand what's happening with PoE. We're going to subscribe to all 3 of those so that we can get a view like this. A view like this tells us what's happening with individual devices, which is what we see in the very bottom. We see gaps. We actually unplug or we turn off these devices at night. Right? These are access points or lights or something like that. And we say, look, in our example here, there's no one using the space. We can physically power off these devices. When we power off these devices, we see the actual utilization of our power supply change. When we power these up, we have a big spike where we go from using about 250 watts of power to using almost 750 watts. Right? We've turned on that much power, that much draw from these PoE devices. For this use case, we've published the dashboard that we were just sharing, as well as the details about the configuration and the data models. We just put this all into like an easy GitHub repository. You can just clone that down or review some of the configuration in there. And same thing on the Grafana dashboard, right? You can clone that into your existing Grafana repository, and the dashboard will be there. Once you turn on the telemetry, data will be populated directly into the dashboard, and you'll be able to understand what's happening over time. OK, so let's wrap it up here about some of the training environments and some of the resources available. We just published our programmability website, or republished this. It has links to a lot of the things that I've been talking about today, as well as the sandboxes and the dojos where we can get hands-on. It has links to all of this stuff. It's developer.cisco.com/iosxe. One thing that you'll find once you go to this is the sandboxes. And that's what I want to talk about here. There's kind of two main sandboxes. You might be familiar with these. There's a reservable sandbox. This is the one that has the telemetry use case built into it. The demo that I showed you, the Grafana dashboard, Yank Suite, all of those tools are baked into the reservable DevNet sandbox. So you can log in, reserve it. It takes a couple minutes to turn on the virtual infrastructure. Then you can log into the Grafana, log into the switches, and actually configure the telemetry or reconfigure the telemetry, because by default, it's on. We're pushing telemetry by default in these training environments as soon as it's turned on. We do also have the always-on sandbox. You can use this for telemetry use cases as well, for NetConf use case and for GNMI dial-in. You will not be able to push telemetry off of the always-on sandbox to your collector. Right? We firewall that out. If you do find a way, let me know, because I'll share that so that we can use it for training. But I haven't been able to get telemetry pushed off of that thing to any of my collectors yet. Just some details about the reservable sandbox. We've got a couple different devices in there, a bunch of different tools. We're supporting telemetry and programmability, as well as the day zero ZTP use cases in here as well. So, the whole automation portfolio that I mentioned at the very beginning, we support hands-on with all of those in these various training environments. We have a deployment guide for, this is specific for wireless, okay? We have a wired model-driven telemetry white paper coming out. I was hoping it'd be published this week. I'm chasing the guys to see what's happening with it, but you will see a model-driven telemetry wired white paper coming out very shortly. That's going to be very in-depth. Everything you need to know about telemetry, or everything I know about telemetry that you need to know. We've got it all on paper. It's about 100 pages now. I've been collaborating for the last couple months. So you'll see this really soon. Again, the learning labs, the blogs, if you search around, you'll be able to find resources for telemetry. Again, the hands-on environment's been refreshed, so it's probably the one-stop shop place to go. The config guide has a lot of the nitty-gritty details from engineering about the telemetry features. So as you do go into production or POC or work with this, definitely I encourage you to review that, because a lot of callouts will be in there. We do have a white paper for the API. We do talk about telemetry in here. But we just touch on it. Again, you'll see the model-driven telemetry white paper coming out shortly. With that, that's all I have. We have 3 minutes left. So I have a demo in the background. So if anyone wants to stick around, I'm going to just switch over to that. I'm logged into my device, show run section telemetry. I wanted just to highlight one of these telemetry configurations in here, which is my 1 minute CPU. Right, I'm pushing it every 20 seconds. Right, every 20 seconds, you're going to get an update about what my CPU is at. It's like 99%. It's at zero. I'm just going to let you in on a secret. We can actually see the raw data in the bottom window here. So if I just tail this telemetry file, you'll see the very last. There's a whole bunch of stuff coming in here, so it's going to just keep blowing over the buffer here. If I just pause it here and I just highlight the very last one that's come in, this is the process CPU. Maybe I'll just bring this up a little bit. This is the process CPU sensor XPath, where we're looking at the 5-second metric. Right? It's at zero. Okay. So this is looking at the raw data. Let's look at this on the actual UI. Here's the UI, right? Very simplified UI. I think I'm looking at like fan speed and CPU. Those are the two that I've got connected in this dashboard right now. If I view this, right, we can see the thing did spike up here to you know, a whopping 5%, sometime around 11. But for the rest of the time, if we zoom in on this and zoom in, let me just zoom it out a little bit here. We can see, you know, every 10 or 20 seconds, whatever we've configured, we have a counter being updated, and we actually have very granular detail about when things are changing in the network. That's my really quick demo where we saw the switch and we saw the visualization engine, which is Grafana. With that, thank you for attending.